Macmillan Audio presents An Irish Country Welcome by Patrick Taylor. Read for you by John Keating. One. Day and night, love sang. My heart, thy dear voice, wakes with joy, like the flower at the sun's bright returning. Dr. Fingal Flaherty O'Reilly leaned back in his chair at the packed Ballybucklebo Bonnocks Sporting Club Hall. Not a sound could be heard but the soaring voice. Flo Bishop, standing behind the microphone on the small stage, let her magical contralto caress the notes of Camille Saint-Saëns' Mon cœur s'ouvre à ta voix, from the opera Samson and Delilah. The song was better known in English as Softly Awakes My Heart. As she sang, her eyes were fixed on those of her husband, Bertie Bishop, who, after he had helped his wife onto the stage, joined O'Reilly's table. The man's eyes were overflowing with adoration, and O'Reilly clearly recalled how, some months ago, when his brother Lars had helped Bertie draw up his will, Bertie had told the two men how he had fallen in love with a 16-year-old Flo McCaffrey at a ceilidh in a church hall many years ago. O'Reilly let the notes flow over him and marvelled at the purity of sound coming from the throat of the rotund wife of the equally spherical councillor Bertie Bishop. Bertie was one of the prime movers behind using the Ballybucklebo Bonnocks Sporting Club on Saturday nights for social events like ballroom dancing, hops and ceilidhs. Bringing the two already tolerant country communities closer together in Ballybucklebo seemed important, given the recent outbreak of sectarian troubles, some violent, that had been going on across the six counties for more than a year. Tonight, Saturday, July 5, 1969, the Bonnocks were hosting the first of what was hoped would be a regular series of talent contests. Bertie's lips were moving, and O'Reilly knew the man was silently mouthing along. O bide here at my side. Promise, ne'er thou'lt depart. O'Reilly glanced around the table, struck suddenly by the other love stories there. Kitty and he had celebrated their fourth wedding anniversary 2 days ago. She caught his eye and smiled. It would have been a longer getaway, but he had promised to attend here tonight. Was it really 38 years since a young Dublin medical student had fallen for a nurse, Kitty O'Halloran from Talla, and in 1935 had left her to pursue his all-consuming interest in his work? She'd taken herself off to Spain during the Civil War to work in an orphanage, and he'd lost track of her. Thanks to his partner, Dr. Barry Laverty, he and Kitty had met again, and the long-cherished embers of their love had burst into fresh flames. Barry sat across from him now, holding the hand of his wife, Sue. 5 years ago, he'd been besotted with Patricia, a young engineering student who'd won a Cambridge scholarship, left Ulster, and broken Barry's heart. He'd been devastated, but some months later had fallen for Sue, paid court, and married her. Now they were expecting. As winds o'er golden grain softly sigh, roving by. Next to Barry was his former classmate, the surgeon Mr. Jack Mills, who sat close beside his fiancée, Dr. Helen Hewitt, although O'Reilly knew the engagement was still a secret. When would they make their plans public? The party was completed by Lord John McNeill, Marquis of Ballybucklebo, and his sister Myrna. Both were widowed, and O'Reilly wondered if they were thinking of their lost loves, perhaps moved as he was by the obvious bond between Bertie Bishop and Flo. He returned his gaze to Flo, took a pull on his pint of Guinness, placed it on the table, and stuck his pipe back in his mouth. He thought of the aria's final words, but in the original French, which his father had insisted he and his brother Lars learn, and which O'Reilly had polished with some French cruiser officers while serving in Alexandria on HMS Warspite during the war. Ah, respond to love's caresses. Join in all my soul expresses. Flo stood for a few seconds, then bowed as deeply as her considerable waist would allow. Bertie was on his feet, hands ready to clap, but before the applause could begin, O'Reilly, with his basso voice, finished the aria with Samson's reply. Dalila, Dalila, je t'aime. Bertie said with a smile, "That's my line, Doctor." The room erupted, not with its usual racket, say for a well-sung Irish song or neatly performed Shannos hard-shoe dance, of whistles, foot-stamping, and cries of, "Ye done good, ye girl, ye!" No, tonight the audience responded with all the decorum that would be accorded a professional opera singer. Flo Bishop was given a standing ovation, and the hand-clapping was deafening. O'Reilly looked over to the contest's judges, Father O'Toole and the Reverend Mr. Robinson. From the way the men were grinning at each other, they were not going to have any difficulty deciding the winner, even if she was one of the event organisers. So far tonight, a Cayley band had played, Alan Hewitt had sung Irish songs, six girl dancers from the Dymphna Kelly School of Dance had skipped and jigged, and even O'Reilly himself had performed a rousing sea shanty, and there was only one more act to come. The applause gradually died, replaced by the scraping of chair legs on the floor as people retook their seats and the dull hum of renewed conversations. A single voice that O'Reilly could not identify remarked above the murmuring, "And Rod Laver beat John Newcomb in Melbourne in the men's tennis finals the day." O'Reilly watched as Councillor Bertie Bishop helped his wife down, hugged her, and, Ulster reticence be damned, planted a firm kiss on her lips, before letting her accept the congratulations of some of the nearest members of the audience. Her place on stage was taken by a carroty-haired, buck-toothed young man. "All right, yous lot, settle down, settle down." He waved his right hand, palm down. "Crikey, Flo, but you done very good indeed. You was sticking out a mile." There was awe in his tone. "You have the voice of an angel, so you have." Flo blushed and inclined her head. More applause. Since Bertie had made Donald a partner in the Bishop Building Company in May, willing the company to him when both bishops died, the Bishops and the Donnellys were on Christian name terms. Indeed, Bertie now treated Donal like the son he'd never had. "I'll say that again," Donal said when a semblance of quiet had returned. "Voice of an angel." "Hey, Mrs. Bishop has that," yelled Dapper Frew, Donal's best friend. "And you, you bollocks, Donal Donnelly, you couldn't carry a tune in a bucket. I hope you're not planning to sing nothing." Much laughter. "Get on with what you're going to say. There's folks here with their tongues hanging out for a jar." Donal Donnelly, carpenter by trade, architect of schemes for separating people like bookies and gullible English tourists from their money, was tonight's master of ceremonies. As was to be expected in a place like Ballybucklebo, there was much good-humoured ribbing between audience and MC. Donal cocked his head sideways, looked askance at his friend and said, "Dapper, away off and chase yourself, you buck agent." More laughter. But Dapper's right about one thing. Well, two things actually. It's true, I couldn't sing in tune if my life depended on it. And with this crowd, it might. And it is time for us to take a wee break before I introduce the last act. So, chat nicely among yourselves, stretch your legs, and yous all know where the bar is." Donal hopped down, and the noise level rose. O'Reilly joined in the general applause, and, as people began moving about the room, he called,
"Bertie, bring Flo over here, so we can congratulate her."
John McNeil said, "Hear, hear." As the couple approached, the men at the table stood, as was proper when a lady joined the company. O'Reilly pulled out his chair.
"Have a pew, Flo."
Before sitting, Flo made a curtsy and said,
"My lord, my lady."
O'Reilly and Bertie remained standing, while the other men took their seats. Above the background noise of voices, Barry overheard Dapper Frew saying to Donald Donnelly, "Do you think them Yankees will get that there Apollo 11 up till the moon this month, and a fella out until the surface?"
"Nah," said Donald. "The moon's a quarter of a million miles away. They'll use special effects, like to make a film in Hollywood. It'll be the best con trick pulled ever."
Dapper laughed. "Takes one till no one." O'Reilly was still chuckling as Barry said, "Hello, Bishops. Flo, you were amazing. And I'm sure everybody wants to congratulate you. But first, may I introduce you to my friend Mr. Jack Mills. Jack, Mr. and Mrs. Bishop." Jack and Bertie shook hands. Flo said,
"Pleased to meet you, Mr. Mills, although I'm sure we've met before, at Fingal and Kitty's wedding 4 years ago."
O'Reilly laughed.
"Of course they did, Barry. Jack here is an honorary member of the community."
John McNeil said, "I must congratulate you, Mrs. Bishop, on a bravura performance." Flo frowned.
"Thank you, sir. My brother means your singing was outstandingly brilliant. I have had the privilege of hearing opera sung in 3 of the world's great opera houses, Covent Garden, La Scala, and the Met in New York, and I have never heard a contralto like yours. You are to be congratulated."
"Thank you, my lady. That's very kind of you."
"Not kind at all. Just the truth, Mrs. Bishop. You must be very proud of Flo, Bertie," Kitty said. O'Reilly had never expected to see Bertie Bishop blush, but he did, and his eyes were damp.
"I've always been proud of my Flo, since she and I danced till my lag and love the night we met. Flo's my Ballybucklebo love, always has been, always will be."
O'Reilly hid a smile behind his hand. He had no doubt that Bertie had always loved his wife, but it wasn't that long ago that the counsellor's behaviour had not been that of the ideal husband. In the 23 years O'Reilly had known Bertie Bishop, the man had gone from unmitigated gobshite to rough-hewn gentleman. O'Reilly frowned when he thought of what it had taken to effect the sea change. Sue said,
"I think that is very sweet, Mr. Bishop."
"Good for you, Bertie," O'Reilly said. "Flo, you were terrific."
"Thank yous all," Flo said. "Now, no more congratulations, please. I'll be getting a swelled head, so I will."
"Just one more, so," Kinky Auchinleck said.
O'Reilly looked in the direction of the distinctive County Cork accent and saw his friend and part-time housekeeper approaching.
"I'm here to offer you, from me and Archie, our most sincere congratulations and," she brought her left hand from behind her back, "a little something from both of us."
She handed Flo a parcel.
"I've heard you sing, Flo Bishop, so unless someone's bribed the judges—"
O'Reilly choked on his stout at that thought.
"Here's an extra prize, some of my chocolate truffles, so, but don't open them now."
"Thanks, Kinky."
Flo accepted the package.
"My Bertie loves your sweets."
"And before you go, Kinky," O'Reilly said, "since you're here, there is one other thing to mention, and it'll not embarrass you, Flo, but you and Bertie and your committee have done a great job organising tonight. And Kinky, you and the ladies who catered have excelled yourselves. Our congratulations and sincere thanks."
"Hear, hear." John McNeil bowed his head in acknowledgement.
Kinky made a little curtsy to his lordship. I'll tell the other lady so, and I'll be off now.
O'Reilly watched her go.
They had all worked like Trojans. He said to Bertie Bishop,
"You'll all be glad of a rest when it's over."
Bertie smiled. "For the others, perhaps. But there's no rest for the wicked, I'm afraid. You know what next Saturday is."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.